Welcome back to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am, as always, Chat Show. Goodbye, Samantha Ward. She's leaving just now. She's had it. The show starts, she splits. That's how it works here. Welcome back to me. I've been away far too long.
Way too long.
Some would say not long enough.
No, I would say just the right amount of time.
Well, but that's just because you got tired of being here in this seat.
It's a lot of work.
You did, first of all, West Side Comedy Theater, thanks to Bryce Whistle and the Fellowship of Owners here. If you're ever in the West Side of Los Angeles, this is the place for you. Go to their website, westsidecomedy.com. Sam, you sat in several times. You got your Jason Ritter.
Uh-huh.
You got your Derek Waters.
Yeah.
You got your...
Good shows. They were good shows.
Somebody else.
Somebody else?
Well, Paget was
Paget
here
did.
With Natasha.
Mark Evan Jackson was in for...
With Wayne Fetterman, who apparently was a huge pain in the ass, Wayne Fetterman.
Mark Evan Jackson, thank you also for sitting in. Wayne Fetterman was the guest who, yes, was a pain in the ass. However, that's expected with a Wayne Fetterman. Right? It's on his rider.
I'm going to be a pain in the ass.
That's a little bit of Lon Harris.
Well, just Jewy, whiny Jew.
You whiny Jew. That's who we are, by the way. I'm going to read my Haftorah before the day is over. So thanks to Paget Brewster as well, and Sammy. Yeah. Upcoming shows. We have a great one today. I'm unbelievably excited. I truly am. Not just because she's sitting across from me at the table.
Yeah, I'm like right here. I already made it.
Next Sunday is Labor Day weekend, so no show. We're back on September 11th with the ridiculous Brett Gelman. Oh, my. Oh, my. I saw that new Joshy movie on the plane with him and the Nick Kroll and the Middle Ditch.
Yep.
Is that a name?
Yes, it is.
Shouldn't be. Then September 18th, The Magician. We were speaking about poker a little bit. Antonio Esfandiari, winner of the largest cash prize poker tournament in history, as well as the number two of all-time poker tournament earnings list. He's just phenomenal. September 25th, that following Sunday, is an evening program live from L.A. Podfest, downtown Los Angeles. Damn special show.
Oh, boy.
Have you become a fan of the Netflix sensation Stranger Things? Because Sheriff Hopper himself, David Harbour, is our guest for that very special September 25th. And then a co-star of our guest today, and Brett Gelman, Judy Greer, will be here on October 9th. Did you know you worked with Judy Greer?
I did. On Lemon? I just worked with Brett Gelman a few weeks ago.
I want to talk about that. Please welcome. Let's just go. Right, Kenny, you ready? Sure.
Yeah.
Let's chat.
All right, Shiri Appleby. So, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Please. Thanks for being had.
Thanks, Sam. I saw that. I felt it. Thank you.
Normally, please welcome Shiri, and then that's where I would applaud.
It's okay. Yeah,
there's normally a big thing, and I just thought we would jump right in.
Let's just do it.
Because we're pretty cash here, as you may have noticed.
I like it.
Mm-hmm. So, I didn't have, as my first question, our acting and working together 17 years ago. I was a child, so you...
I was just born.
You were a fetus in shoes.
I was just born, yeah.
I was so young.
But I saw in the research that your first acting job in primetime television was a show 30-something.
Oh.
That was my first primetime television work also.
Amazing.
The same year, but there's no way it could have been the same episode. Come on.
I played Hope in Flashback.
Huh.
So I was like Hope as a child.
You wouldn't possibly remember who directed the episode.
I could barely remember being alive. I don't remember who.
Yeah,
was
so you were.
I must have been six.
Right.
Yeah, something very young.
Yeah, and so your mom teaches Hebrew school.
Yep.
Your dad's working as an executive in an office.
Right.
In telecommunications, it says.
Right.
So that must be either the fringe of show business.
Pretty vague.
Or not show business.
Yeah.
Pretty vague.
Yeah.
He could have been taking calls at Comcast for all I know, but
something
I doubt
like
it.
No.
But so at six, who says you know what you should do?
Well, I started at three.
Sure, of course.
And to be honest with you, I think they just thought that I was cute and they'd put me in show business. They had always told me that I was really shy and they were trying to do something to get me out of my shell. And then now I have a daughter who's three and she's incredibly outgoing.
So you're trying to keep her away from
and
show business.
And so, no, my husband was like, tell her the truth. There's no way that she was shy. like, just admitted to her, because I've, like, spent my whole life thinking that I was this really shy kid that's been meant to be very outgoing. And finally, my mother was like, oh, your dad just made up that story. I was like, I've been in therapy for, like, 20 years trying to figure this out. Maybe I'm, like, somebody I'm not supposed to be, like, really dark, heavy stuff. My mom was like, no, you were just cute. We thought it'd be fun to put you in show business.
Now, as a fairly new mom, isn't that par for the course, that mom thinks her daughter is adorable?
Yeah, and especially growing up in Los Angeles, to be honest with you, people are always like, oh, your daughter's so cute, you should put her in commercials. It happens already all the time. So I'm like, oh, I see why my parents went that direction. I can now understand the choice.
Right.
But having been a child actor, it's not the choice that I'm going to make. But I don't fault them for doing it. It's worked out great.
Of course.
I'm here talking with you.
But at three, right, that's right. You've reached the apex. So at three, it's just...
It was just like an activity.
Yeah, exactly.
It was just an activity.
That makes sense. Yeah. Now that seems completely fine and healthy.
Yeah.
Until we get to, honey, these are your sides.
Right.
Let's run the scene. For the audition.
But it still felt pretty fun.
Like, activities.
I really had a good time. Like, I think if I had ever, my brother, they put my brother in the business for a month and he did a commercial and a movie and then decided that was it, he wasn't interested, and that was it. It was never brought up again. I really liked it. I mean, I'm clearly still doing it.
Yeah, no,
so
of course.
I really like it.
Our very own Sam Levine started as a preteen as well.
Teen-ish. 13.
Young.
Yeah.
But I still really like it. I mean, sure. I'm more passionate about it now than I've really ever been. So,
right.
But as a kid, it was like an activity. It gave me like a really strong sense of self. I knew who I was. And it was great. You know, I've grown up being financially independent, which is for anybody wonderful, but especially a young woman, to grow up and just be like, I know how to make money. I know how to like take care of myself.
Right. And the research also showed that there was a sense from your parents that the family was going to remain normal, your brother's playing soccer, and you're studying.
That's right. I remember, like, really having a big meltdown one time where I was, like, about to test for a show, and then they said the show was going to shoot in, like, Arizona or New Mexico, whoever was giving the tax credit at that time. And my parents said, no, I couldn't go to the test, and I, like, flipped out. But they were like, there's no way, we're not breaking up our family for you to go be on some television show.
Good for them?
Good for them.
Yeah.
Absolutely good for them.
That show was Breaking Bad.
I don't even know what show it was. Breaking Bad.
No, we had Bryan Cranston here, and he said, you know, I read the script for Breaking Bad, and before I read it, they told me this is going to shoot in...
Like New Mexico.
New Mexico.
Right.
And I told my wife that, and she said, we're not going to New Mexico. And I said, no, of course not. And then I went in the other room and read the script, and I came back, and I said, honey, I think I got to move to New Mexico.
Yeah.
You'll visit on the weekends.
I know. We do it now. Yeah. We're in Vancouver.
Yeah, it seemed, I worked with the actress who plays your mom.
She's lovely.
Yeah, I did. What did I do? Was it, it might have been yes, it was. It was the Ricky Gervais special correspondence. She is lovely. She's flippant and a real broad.
Mm-hmm. She's wonderful. We got dark and crazy together.
Yeah. Yes. On the show or?
No, on the show.
Yeah.
On the show.
How Jewy, just literally a question.
Yeah.
How Jewy was your upbringing?
Pretty
Mom's
Jewy.
Teaching
my mother's a Hebrew teacher. I could sing my haftorah right now. Et Adonai. I mean, I could keep going.
If you keep going, we have to pay royalties.
That's it. He said, I'll stop right there. That was as far as I can go. Super Jewy. Grew up keeping kosher.
No.
Went to Hebrew school, which I got kicked out of.
Now that I want to hear.
I got kicked out of because I would have boys pick me up from Hebrew school, and I was like ditching Hebrew school, and they were like, you can't graduate. I was like, I don't really care.
This is
going to mean nothing in the long scheme of things to my life.
And looking back, you still agree with that?
Fine, no problem. Not a problem. I went. I got it. Super religious. Religious, but super, like, committed to the faith, and my whole family, both sides of our family, are really into it.
Traditions and...
All of
did
it.
You do your... The birthright trip?
No. I like looked at the brochure and I saw the kids and I was like, they look like nerds. I don't want to go. My brother did it. That's how my parents met. My mother's Israeli. My dad was 16. He went on birthright and they took him to like a girls' boarding school and he brought along like a 16mm camera and shot it. And so he had it. And then cut 2 years later, he's living in a Sherman Oaks apartment building. There's these two Israeli women there, and he's wearing a chai around his neck. And they start talking. He said, oh, come upstairs to my apartment. I'll show you this video for my trip. And he puts on the video, and my mother's on it.
That's insane.
That's how they met, and then 2 weeks later, they got married.
2 weeks later?
Because otherwise, he had to marry her. He's never going to see her again. Because she had to go back to Israel. So he proposed, they got married, and there's, I mean, it's 40-something years, they're still married.
That's spectacular.
That's who
one of the greatest stories I've ever heard.
And I told it so fast. I was like, that's my family's life. Bye.
Yeah, you told that story a couple times, apparently, because we were enjoying it.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, good. I'm so glad. I was like,
let's not forget the tremendous cheerleading. Calabasas High School.
That's right. I was a sophomore cheerleader.
Voted most spirited.
Most spirited. I was a yearbook editor for
2 years.
We got
class clown, by the way.
You got class clown? Yeah. I was most spirited. My eighth grade yearbook, I won most likely to succeed. So they called it then.
Well, you were already working. They'd seen you.
They were working. They were like, that bitch, she'll work hard for a dollar.
Okay, so what I like also is the off to USC, and then in 99, of course, was a life-altering year that dragged you back into the acting game. No, I'm not talking about Roswell. Mm-hmm. I'm speaking, of course, of a little film called Deal of a Lifetime.
That's right.
Which Jamie found, I think, in the discount bin for $3.
No, I think I had to, like, find it, like, on Amazon or something for $5.
But it's still out there. It's still out there.
I made a point to get all of Kevin's movies.
Cute.
On DVD.
But mostly
that's
to
really
torture
cute.
Me.
No.
What she doing?
You're going to want them.
At my weekly. Yeah,
this is me being my mother. You're going to want them.
You are going to want those. That's
my
awesome.
My weekly poker game, she'll have one of them playing on the TV as my friends arrive, and then they think I was sitting home alone watching myself.
I've done that.
That's
on
like
occasion.
A most
I've
embarrassing thing. That would like give me like sweats just yeah. like everywhere.
Sometimes I'll go through the guide and I'll see something I was in and I'm like, I want to. No, I can't.
I can't.
God forbid Jamie comes upstairs and sees I'm watching something
myself.
I was in. That would be the worst.
I've caught you doing that once or twice.
Sure. No, it's happened.
And I'm like, are you watching yourself?
She's only talking about half the things she caught him doing when he was watching.
I was going to say, like, I had a dirty thought, but I can't move past it.
So your memories from Deal of a Lifetime, because I don't have many.
Okay, so I do.
Okay.
So it was like, this was a big part for me. This was a big part for me.
It was a lead, yeah. It was a...
And it was like during my high school years, I decided, I made a really conscious decision. I had been really obsessed with 90210. And I first walked on the campus of Calabasas High School, and I was like, this is the best thing ever. I'm not going to work. So I'd go to auditions, but kind of like, you know when you can get an audition and not get an audition?
Yeah.
I'd take it very far to know I was still in the game, but never seal the deal, close the deal. And so once I had to figure out like where I wanted to go for college, I was either going to go to USC and still act or go to Santa Barbara. And my mom and I sat outside the house, and she was like, let's do it for one more month. If you get a job in 1 month, go to USC and keep acting and take it as a sign. Or if you don't get a job, say acting was something you did as a kid and go to Santa Barbara with your friends and move on. So in a month, I did like a Taco Bell commercial and some random internet pilot. And I don't even know if it was internet. I don't know what it was.
1999
internet.
It
was like
pilot.
Not even internet. It was like way ahead of its time. No, some random pilot.
But and you did ring the bell.
And then I went to USC, and then I got that job, and it was like a very, you were in it, but it was like, and the guy that was
don't
starring,
laugh
no,
at that.
He was, no, the guy was in it was on Party of Five, and there was all these young up and coming actors.
The male lead, the young
the male lead. So the funny story I have about this is, so whenever you're an actor and you're on set, you're always mic'd. And so you always, like, there's one moment that you've learned in your life, like, oh, my God, I have to not talk now, Mike, or I can't say anything, was on this movie together because I was, like, making out, kissing this young guy, like, in his trailer. And then we, like, go on to set to shoot the scene, and it's in a car. And I didn't know that they had such things as a car mic. And he was saying something. I mean, it was so PG, I can't even remember what it was. And I looked over, and you and the producers had headphones on and were laughing, like hearing us like talking about it, like knocked down, so embarrassed. They bumped my head on the dashboard. And from then on, I've been super like fanatic of like, oh my God, there's a mic on me, don't say anything.
Well, much better than how Stallone found out he was mic'd. But I you don't know this?
Please. Share. You can't drop a
for the
you
seven.
You can't drop a Stallone story.
For the
without.
Seven people who don't know, Cradle.
Sure.
Oh, Cradle My Balls.
Yeah.
Yeah, Cradle
My
Balls
came from Struck the Shaft, Cradle the Balls. Say my name. Come on. Say my name.
Because he had a mic on, right?
He was mic'd
yeah,
in the trailer.
Yeah, he's mic'd in the trailer.
Yeah, with a PA. Don't get any ideas.
I've heard that story.
Yeah.
But I think about you all the time
because
when I'm
of
putting
that.
A mic
every time
on.
You smack your head.
Kevin Pollak.
Kevin Pollak listening.
Kevin Pollak's watching
somewhere. That is so funny. So. I'm trying to remember, the director's name is Levine? I want to say Levine.
Okay.
He did not go on to an illustrious career as far as I know. But I remember the producer coming in my trailer one day and sitting down and talking about how important the film was, and I thought, well, you're an idiot. Important. You hit the number, pal. That's why I'm here.
That's it.
But then I ended up having a lot of fun because I got to play a lot of different wacky characters.
Yeah, you were like the devil.
I was an assistant, I believe.
Oh, sorry. Assistant to the devil.
Yeah.
I remember pretty well. I mean, like, because I said, it was like a very big moment in my career at the time. And so I like could vividly remember shooting all those scenes.
But it says the same year as Roswell, which must have been shortly.
It was before. That was before.
Yeah.
And then, so I went I went to USC for a semester. I was doing Xena Warrior Princess. Kind of like on the cusp in my mind. And I did a pilot for the WB that got picked up. It went to series. It was a comedy. And I got fired.
After the pilot?
After the pilot, they recast me.
Which happens?
It happens to everybody. I think it's kind of a rite of passage, but it had never happened to me before in my now 16-year career.
Have you ever known anyone who got fired after the table read of the pilot?
I think it happens more frequently.
It's a lot more common now than it used to.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
And so I got fired, and then I was like hanging out in Hollywood, like making that movie, but also just like not having anything to do.
Right.
So I was like, I'm going to go back to USC, because I had dropped out. I'm going to go back to USC, but I'm going to get a TV show so I can drop out of college for good, because I don't like it, but I need to have something to do. So for whatever reason, I got my Christmas break of my sophomore year, I made the pilot for Roswell, went back, finished my sophomore year, and then the day after I finished the entire year, the show got picked up, and we did 3 seasons.
Crazy.
So. Yeah.
Not bad.
No.
That plan worked really well.
It worked out really well for
me. Has any plan worked out that well since? They rarely do.
They really rarely do, but I was pretty...
And the auditioning process was not an easy one on Roswell, according to the research.
No.
Dear Lord.
No, it was really the first time I learned the big lesson of, which I really believe now, is that like you have to do everything for yourself in this business. Not to say anything about working with a team, but it's a very much like a proactive, you get rewarded for being proactive.
100%.
And so a friend of mine, this guy, AJ Buckley, who's a really good actor, he told me there's this new show that's casting. I called my agent. My agent said that they're not interested in seeing you. At that time, I had never even heard of that. Like, I didn't know that they could be interested or not interested in seeing you. Didn't understand.
Yeah, you just got on a list and you went in and read.
I didn't understand. I was 18. And so AJ knew the director, David Nutter. And so he gave him my picture and resume. I came in. I had a terrible audition. Then they brought me in like 3 weeks later, and I went through the process like 7 times, but constantly having to be like, I think it was like 4 or 5 auditions in before I read for the lead, because I didn't have a lot of fans. I also was like nobody. And so
you were a college freshman.
I was a college. And so I literally came to the test with like my backpack sitting there in between things, like fake, like studying. But it was like a really big job. I mean, it's still the biggest
huge
job of my life to this day.
Really?
Well, because
in terms of changing.
Changing the trajectory of your life and the trajectory of your career.
Yeah.
For sure.
And you got to work with great people. And also, was Comic-Con a thing in 99?
No.
Not the thing it is now.
No, it wasn't a thing. And like those conventions, none of that. And there was no paparazzi. There was nothing like that. It was a very.
Because that show would have been insane. It's totally different. For Comic-Con.
That would have been great.
They actually...
Your character married an alien.
My character married an alien.
They did have a very protected set.
Ours did?
Yeah.
Why so? I know you guys were across the street.
You guys shot at Paramount. We were shooting Freaks and Geeks at Raleigh. Mm-hmm. And I remember on a few occasions we would go over there, and they were like, who are you here to see? What are you here to do?
That's so funny.
We were like, we have friends on the show. They were like,
I came over to
check.
See you guys a few times.
Yeah.
And he took great photos of me.
Gabe Sachs?
Exactly. Yep, Gabe Sachs.
Sound like you said gay sex.
Nope. But you can take that up with Gabe.
By the way,
he's heard that
my
before.
Favorite photographer
is gay sex. he's hot. He's doing some pretty...
If he weren't as handsome and successful as he is, the name might bother him.
Yeah. That's funny. It was a long time ago.
It was a long time. Mm-hmm. Well, 99.
Yeah, 99.
Let's all reminisce
about
the
90s. Let's all think about 99 together. I think I might have done End of Days in 99. Is that possible? That sound like
that was the summer that I worked at the movie theater, and it was a really good year for movies.
It came out in 99.
Yeah.
So you probably shot it in 98.
Probably. Yeah. That was a good year for movies, 99?
It was a really good year
sure.
for movies.
One of the best.
You got Deal of a Lifetime.
Matrix.
End of Days.
American Beauty.
The South Park movie. Phantom Menace, which I know isn't a great movie, but it's still important. It is important.
It is.
We veered off.
But also, I think the magnitude of a gig like Roswell is, as you say, that moment where you feel like you're in show business. You mentioned Paramount. There's something about driving on a lot to go to work that suddenly it's 1940 and you're in a, you know, you're legitimately in show business.
It feels very important. You're driving on that lot. You're like, I'm here to do something. I've been like been included and welcomed into the establishment.
Yeah.
And for like a young kid at 20, I don't know that like it was a tremendous amount of responsibility. Like my friends, I was sharing an apartment with a friend of mine who was in college, and they would be coming in at like 5:30 from like raves and on ecstasy, and I'd be like, you guys can sleep on my bed. I got to go to work. And that's when like your life starts to like veer in different directions. Being a child, you know, you're still a child and you're like number one on a call sheet, and you're there back then like 18, 19 hours a day, which they don't do anymore because it's so expensive. But like it was just a lot of responsibility. But at the same time, it's sort of like falling in love for the first time where you're like, oh my God, this is exactly how I don't want it to go again. But at least I've fallen in love and now I know what I want.
Right.
And so it was kind of like, wow, this is like the worst way to be the star of a television show. And this is sort of like learning what about publicity and politics and what is the game, sort of having a crash course in that.
Right.
And then, so the next time, each time you do it, it sort of gets better, and I feel like you're stronger and more equipped to lead.
So you had the headbang incident on Deal of a Lifetime.
Right.
What were some of those learning curve moments, if you can think of any, from Roswell? Because this is one of the things that I, you know, you've directed now, mm-hmm. and as a first-time director, I met with actors who directed and asked them specifically, what are those moments you wish you could have back? Because those are the learning moments, and you want to learn from your own mistakes, but you'd love to hear other people's.
Well, I think my mistake, like my major mistake back then, was not understanding what the game is of starring on a television show and how much you actually have to gain if you play the game right. So like, for instance, like I didn't understand publicity. Still to this day, publicity is a little bit, like I'll do everything, but it's a little bit of a head scratch about like, what's the goal of this?
Yes.
What's the goal of this? And so back then, like the year before, I had been fired from the same network that had now acquired, because Roswell was originally a show for Fox. And I had said to my agents, I can't audition for the WB because I've been fired last season. They don't like me. So the show was acquired. And so, you know, I hire a publicist, I get all this stuff, and they were like, here it is, we want her to be on the cover of 8 magazines, and we're gonna turn her into Sarah Michelle Gellar and Carrie Russell and Katie Holmes and all these people. And so I went to the president of the network by myself. I sat in there and I was like, I'm not ready to be famous yet. I said, I don't know who I am. And last season you told me I'm not good enough. And this season you're telling me now I'm ready to be a star and I'm just not ready.
Wow.
And she said, okay, understood. I said, because she's like, your publicist is saying no too many times. I'm like, I'm not ready. I'm just, I want to just focus on the acting.
And do you, what? Go back to that headspace.
Yeah.
And what percentage would you say was a youthful insecurity? Because everyone's insecure their entire lives about something. Youthful insecurity, but dovetailing with lack of experience in terms of, I'm just trying to get my footing here. I'm trying to feel like I belong, a sense of that.
It was a sense of that, of also like I kind of felt like I was saying something sort of brave. Like, I thought it would sort of be like a respected thing. Like, oh, you're so brave for admitting this.
So
Let us walk you through the process. Mm-hmm. I thought that would sort of be like, wow, you're so emotionally together to acknowledge this. And instead it was no problem. And then the focus of the show goes another direction.
To
another actor who is ready to promote the show, which I understand from a business point of view. But then you're like, whoa, I went from being the star of the show to being in the front of the cast photo to now being in the back of the cast photo. My doing, my fault, nobody else's fault but my own. And then like not understanding the politics of you show up, you say your lines. There are no emotions about whatever's going on politically behind the scene. Like you come, you execute, and you go home. And you do whatever's asked of you.
Right.
That's sort of the game. I think.
The game is to be a real pro.
Just be a professional.
And if someone places the brass ring in your hand,
you take it and you run to the hill until someone tries to grab the brass ring away. And you're like, I'm not giving it back. I'm not done with it
Precious.
Yet. Yes. So I kind of learned all that. And I sort of learned, like, you know, you just don't need to engage. Like, if someone wants to play games, they're allowed to play games. I'm just not invested. I'm not interested.
Ah, yeah. The soap opera.
Yeah, I'm just not interested. So I learned about all that stuff.
And yeah,
so
whatever happened to that Suzanne Daniels?
Yeah,
anyway.
That Suzanne, she's doing fine. I think she's running.
She's quite all right.
She's like a CEO somewhere else. She's doing great. And it was a great lesson for me.
That's pretty spectacular.
Yeah.
And also, I think, helpful to those out there that are wondering.
What the hell happened to her career?
No, that are wondering what to avoid. Because the truth is, I had not heard that particular example before. You get a show and the network says, your publicist is turning too much work down. What the hell is your problem?
Mm-hmm.
And you have the wherewithal. And then it sounds a little bit like a sense of you really didn't feel ready, but also you were looking to sort of stand your ground and gain a little respect, which is pretty amazing for a 20-year-old. Because you don't think in terms of how this could go wrong.
No.
And put you in the back of the cast photo.
That's right.
That doesn't go through your head. And there's nobody there to tell you it might happen. So if anyone's out there, get to the front of the cast photo,
That's
I think,
right.
is the takeaway. So one of your co-stars on the show, Colin Hanks. He's a pal of the show. And then you end up working with his pop in Charlie's War. People look like, through the research, love to. I think you've probably been asked that a time or six.
About what? About
working with father and son.
Yes, it was amazing.
Yeah, of course.
It was amazing. When I went to do Charlie Wilson's War, which was a huge opportunity for me, Mike Nichols gave me the job in the room, which never happens.
Please tell us just a little bit about
of
that.
Of course. So okay. We were talking about New York.
You and Mike Nichols.
You and I.
Oh, you and I.
And I said that, like, whenever my career was sort of, I sort of moved to New York bi-coastally when I was like 27, mostly because I was single, and I was like, I don't want to really just date the producers in LA because I'm going to need jobs from them, and I'm not really going to settle down, so I don't really want to reject everyone I need work from. So I'll get an apartment in New York so I can go back and forth and have two different dating pools. This was sort of my thought process. And so every time my career
was... It sounds like all the producers in LA wanted to, or enough
I
of them...
I had the options. I had options. So.
But it was getting tricky.
I was just like, this is a bad career move. So let me go to New York where I can date whoever I want. And it won't affect my career.
Wow.
And so then I was in New York, and you could get into much larger audition rooms because you're a much bigger fish in a small pond. So I went and met the casting director, Ellen Lewis. She liked me. She said, okay, you're going to come back to Mike Nichols' office, and you're going to read for him. And I wore essentially a slip,
sure.
which was like V-necked, boobs up, just barely covering my tush, pair of cowboy boots, like all saucy. Hello, Mr. Nichols. Nice to meet you, blah, blah, blah. I sit down. I talk to him for a while. I tell him about being Jewish and whatever. And he goes, you remind me a lot of Natalie. And I was like, oh, my God, Natalie Portman, my whole life. And so I act. I do my thing. He starts laughing. And I was like, what's so funny? He goes, you're being so serious, and yet you're dressed like that. It was like very... Yeah, I was like, well, thank you. And so then the end of the audition, he's like, I feel good as you as Jailbait. How do you feel? I'm like, oh, my God, I feel great.
That's right. The name of the character
is Jailbait. Yeah, so it really worked out
for
me.
Whether she was dressed appropriately.
Yeah, and so I like called my parents walking out, like, I can't believe I just got this job. And then the table read was back at Paramount, and it was on an entire soundstage. And, you know, it was like every single person had a name card. And Tom Hanks and Julie Roberts and Philip Seymour Hoffman, Aaron Sorkin, they're all at one end. And I'm on the opposite end because, you know, I'm starting out. So I'm at this end. And all I learned, it was so fabulous. Like, each movie star, like, makes their entrance and comes and sits down. And then the next movie star comes in and sits down. And then you wait for everyone to show up.
Yeah.
And then Tom Hanks sat down. The room got quiet. And he was like, you, I know you. I'm happy to see you here. Across the table, and I was like, it was such a welcome, like, welcome into the community.
Yeah.
And then the table read started, and the whole time he was just such a lovely guy, as you can imagine.
He has one of the longest episodes of the show. Tom went 2 hours 42 minutes with a Pabst Blue Ribbon in each hand at one point. Couldn't shut him up.
Nope.
Nope. He had a good time.
He was ready to talk.
Then good for him.
Yeah, yeah. Good for us.
Yeah. That's right.
Apparently it was good for him because he had enough fun to stay for a while. He also said yes and 4 years later showed up.
He took his time. Yeah. He had to do his research. He had to do his research.
He had to do his research. We have a segment on the show called Famous Questions. And these are not questions that are famous themselves throughout history, one might think, but rather questions that are written by famous people specifically to you.
Oh.
Yeah, it's really my way of showing off that I know famous people.
Are you serious?
Am I serious about knowing
this
famous
people? This is
real? People?
Yeah, it's real.
Or is this about to happen? Well, you know, famous is relative. We've been talking.
Anderson, my mother.
So I'm going to read the question, and then you can decide whether or not you know who it is. How about that?
Oh, my God, that's so wild. Okay.
Or annoying. Depends on how you look at it.
Okay.
Shiri's one and of the only people I knew to actually take writing classes while living in New York, even though she was a working actress who was making a damn good living. Next thing I know, she's also directing. Ask her how has the steps she has taken behind the camera changed her approach to acting in front of the camera?
That's a great question. Can you tell me who wrote it?
Well, there was one part that I left out that would have made it obvious, which is, next thing I know, I'm being directed by her for an online short.
Oh, okay, so that's Colin.
Colin Hanks.
That's so sweet of him to say, yes.
Also, why so rad? Why is she so rad?
Oh, that's so nice.
He is an angelic fella.
That's really great.
So you're in NYC,
trying
to not date producers, and you decide...
to take writing classes.
Take some writing.
I love writing. Yeah. So I always take writing classes as much as I can.
Is that something you fell in love with at school?
No, my mother had me like write in a diary since I was like 3 years old. She would like dictate it when I was young. Like I would just say it and she'd write it down, and I've kept a journal my whole life.
Wow.
And I just love writing. And how is directing? I think what's been interesting about directing and producing is the more and more I've gotten behind the camera, is you see, I have more of a perspective on what the role actually is of the actor. Like, I always thought as the actor that they spend so much time talking about the actors and it's all about the actors. And you realize that you're rarely mentioned. You're just more of like a logistic.
You start to understand why Hitchcock considered them furniture.
Yeah, it's basically, in the most respectful way, you're bringing these characters to life and you're bringing the emotion, and people have to actually relate to you or feel for you or empathize with you to tell the story. But in terms of the actual physical production, I've learned that my job is to show up on time, know my lines, be very courteous, sweet, and then get out of the way so that they can set up the next shot and be ready to go again. And like, I don't sit behind the camera. I'm not sitting behind the monitors. I'm not schmoozing. I'm like out of the way. But
you learn more of that from directing.
From producing and directing.
Right.
Producing mostly is where I really learned that.
Get the actors out of the way.
Just like get out of the way. Like give them their space. They actually have a lot to do in 12 hours, and they're stressed out about how to do it. So like if I have any questions before I'm shooting something, I've already asked them. So like when I come to work now on the show, like I've done all my homework. I go through the entire episode with my acting coach. I don't have any questions to ask. I've already figured it out. I'm just here to shoot so we can make our day.
Wow. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, because there's no time.
There's never enough time.
There's no time.
Yeah.
So I'm just ready to shoot. I don't...
I had always heard from other actors when watching, hear actors say, I don't like to look at myself in something because all I see are the mistakes I made. I'm so painfully enamored with everything I do that I've never really felt that way until I directed. And then when I directed, all I see are the mistakes and the horrible things that we didn't have time enough to fix.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I've been thinking about it lately where like I always have liked to do like for any take like 6 or 7 different options in terms of like what do I give them. Let me give them as many different options so that when they go into editing they can cut together a great performance. A really wonderful director, Doug Liman, always gave me this example of what filmmaking is like.
He's a great director.
He's a great director. So he's always compared filmmaking to cooking, whereas like writing the script is like writing the recipe. Shooting is like going to the supermarket and getting your ingredients, and editing is actually being at home and cooking the meal and putting all the pieces together. So when I'm acting...
I see how you met your husband.
Yeah.
With that analogy.
He's sort of a cook director. But when I'm acting, I always like to give them as many ingredients as possible so that they can make your performance as flavorful as possible. But now that I've been directing, I'm also like, oh no, I'm giving them so many options. I don't know what their taste is like.
Right.
Am I giving them the whole world and that they're going to put something together that I don't really respect and that's not what I would cut together?
Right.
So it's been a little bit, I've been looking at it like that. But I'm still very much of the school of thought of like, once I've done it one way, I have to do it another way, and then I'll do it another way so I feel like I've given you everything.
Yeah, and also it should be on the director to encourage you in one direction or the other while you're giving them a variety.
That's right.
Because sometimes I noticed when I got to editing, there was a lack of consistency while the actor attempted to give me choices.
Oh, in terms of tone?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
It started to stretch the tone.
Oh, interesting.
When they were experimenting, giving me different takes, and I thought, yeah, those four versions of this character you keep giving me, I don't need.
I don't need. I just need this one over here.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right. But that's up to a director
to
decide. And
to me, because when it was happening, it was, wow, look at all these great choices I'm going to have. And I thought, yeah, these four, I never.
Do you find that that's because it was a comedy? Because I hear that, like, in comedies now, they let the actors improvise so much that whenever they put stuff together, it's not consistent.
Can't match it.
Yeah, it's hard to match. Is that?
Yeah, that's a great, thank you. I think that is probably.
See,
more.
I come up with something smart every sixth show.
That's why you're the head writer.
I just talked to Brett Gelman about this in his movie because it's him. He's in every frame, and yet all these wonderful actors come in for like 2, 3, 4 days.
Right.
And I said, you're the only one that's going to know. You and Janixa are the director are the only ones going to know the tone of this movie. I don't know what the tone of this movie is because I'm only here for a minute.
But everyone should know.
Everyone should know
the tone.
You should know, but it's a very...
Yeah.
When you're there all day, every day, you can help, like, really establish it.
And Brett Gelman has such a ridiculous range of insanity as played real.
As real. That's right.
He can be very dry and very ridiculous in the same moment, which is kind of a rare gift.
It was awesome.
Yeah.
I loved it.
He wrote the film.
With Janix, I believe,
Who directed it?
Yeah.
Lemon, it's called.
Uh-huh, Lemon.
Yeah. Pretty excited about that.
Me too.
Yeah. So, you first directed in the series after Dating Rules. No, you produced Dating Rules for My Future, but did you also direct an episode?
Yeah, I directed that.
You did, yeah. Mm-hmm. And that was your first time directing?
Mm-hmm. I produced the first season. I got really invested in it. And the woman that came in to direct it, her name was Liz Allen. And they asked me to come back and do the second season to do a small part. And she said, tell them the only way you'll do it is if you can direct it.
Because she knew you might want to do it.
She knew I wanted to do it. And she was like, this is an opportunity. It's on the web. And they need you.
Right.
So get it.
Pretty great.
It was great advice.
Yeah.
So I did it.
You say you love writing.
Mm-hmm.
So... Have you been writing original?
I have features I've written.
And what's that experience like for you?
I mean, I've taken a lot of classes on it too. I love it. I always feel like writing something is my way of calling in the material from the outside sources on that theme or that topic. So anytime I've spent time, like before I did Dating Rules for My Future Self, I was writing a book for young women about like how to sort of form your life. And I wrote this book. I have the book, but you know it's hard to sell a book. And so I wrote this book, and then all of a sudden this project came to me with very similar themes. And now
right.
I wrote a movie about dating and being married, and then now I'm developing something with a writer in a similar world.
Is that about how difficult it is to date while married?
No. Wouldn't that be funny? How to have the perfect open marriage.
No such thing.
No, yes, no, I don't think that's it.
I'm always additionally fascinated by people's writing rituals. And, you know, there are those who can give themselves, I'm going to write between these hours, whatever comes, comes.
Mm-hmm.
I've talked to writer directors on the show about the process of what a first draft means to you.
Mm-hmm.
In my experience, it's always been, I love rewriting.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I could rewrite anyone's script. Like the last thing I directed, I did a page one rewrites, six of them. Because you're going to do that anyways when you direct it. If the script's in phenomenal shape, which this one
wasn't
in certain areas, that's one thing. But In terms of tone, in terms of pace, in terms of rhythm, especially as Jamie said, because it's a comedy, there are such musical rhythms and the tone is so much more important. That I feel like the first draft is just a skeleton that you're going to rewrite a zillion times and add layers of organs and skin and hair and what have you.
Mm-hmm.
And that when I write that first draft, there is no contemplating which way to go when you get to a fork in the road. Just
keep going.
Just pick.
Mm-hmm.
And also when you start the next day, don't reread what you wrote the day before.
Mm-hmm.
Read maybe half a page just to get back into speed. Don't start celebrating this, what you've been working on,
because mm-hmm.
it's still shit, I promise
mm-hmm.
you. I'm also one of those, the moment I write like 3 or 4 pages, I get super excited and I want someone to read it.
That's cute.
Do you ever have that?
No.
do you ever let anyone read your stuff?
Pretty rarely. And the few times I have, I've always given it over being like, I'm ready to make it, right? And then you get so many notes and it always is a source of like insecurity, like almost like, I know, I see it in my head, I see how this works, and people aren't seeing it in the same way, and so it's almost like I get pleasure out of writing it.
Not so much out of feedback.
No, not out of the feedback.
I think because...
I think we all hate feedback.
I don't like the feedback.
I don't like the feedback either, and I get really upset. I write sketch comedy, and like when we're reading it, I was like, why aren't they laughing in the parts that I want them to laugh at?
Because it's so clear to you.
Yeah,
it's
so clear to me. Like, I know if I could take one of these scripts and put it on its feet, I'm like, I know how I could make this work. I see it in my head, and so it's discouraging to me that I'm not able, that I don't have that skill as a writer to communicate it well enough for the other people to see it the way I see it. That frustrates me.
Yeah.
And it makes me feel like I'm not good enough, and I don't like feeling that way.
No.
Like, J-Mac was reading something of mine recently in the other room, and I'm like, I don't hear any laughter.
Absolutely.
Where's the laughter?
Absolutely.
And he's like, I'm acting out the characters.
And then, you know, you just hit an interesting point of this, which is maybe the best feedback is showing me where I didn't articulate what I mean. You don't necessarily, I don't necessarily have to care whether or not you think it's funny or good.
Mm-hmm.
Just tell me what's not clear.
Mm-hmm. And I can make it more
specific. And I can better clarify my point of view in the scene or a character.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be the best kind of feedback.
Mm-hmm.
I would think the best kind of feedback would be, you know, like if Steven Zalian or Aaron Sorkin reads your script. I feel like they'd have pretty good feedback. I would trust that.
What are you referring to?
Oh, not anything specific.
Oh.
I'm just saying, in my mind, if I wrote a script and I handed it and I emailed it to like 10 friends, I just know I'd look at the feedback and I go, what the fuck does he know?
Well, you have to factor in your 10 friends. Yes, you're right.
If no, I send my stuff to like specific people that I value their opinion.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. But then I read, who's the great author that did Princess Bride?
Whoopi Goldberg.
Yep.
I can tell you who directed it.
Adventures in the Screen Trade was the famous book that he wrote.
Mm.
He wrote All the President's Men. You guys know who I'm talking about.
There's a computer. Do you want to IMDb?
Yeah, please look that up. So he wrote on this very topic of when friends give you their material to read.
Mm-hmm.
He said, initially, I would give them very honest, straightforward feedback, thinking this is why they gave me
their scripts,
their material.
Mm-hmm.
And then I realized none of my friends wanted to hear
William Goldman.
William mm-hmm. Goldman to block Peter, now Alec. No, he's the Match Game, not Hollywood Squares. I just digressed myself into a rabbit hole. He said, I realized that none of them wanted the truth. They wanted to just hear, this is great.
Mm.
You're on the right path. Keep working it.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause when I got into specifics, they always seemed to feel like I didn't get it. I didn't get what they saw.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, eventually with some friends, it gets to the point where I realized they just want encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
And so he said, I just figured out a ways to encourage my friends who care. But I found that helpful as a director. You know, I studied some of the ridiculously great directors I was fortunate enough to work with,
mm-hmm.
the way that they talk to actors in terms, because I thought, well, I'm an actor, I can talk to actors.
Mm-hmm.
And then a lot of times I spend with actors, nobody wants to talk about acting because it just seems so self-important and
I totally disagree. Like, that's the thing that I'm the most fascinated by, is that
like as a young actor starting out, I have notebooks filled with like all the things I cut out from the actors that I liked that said things about how do you create the craft and what is the craft, and like taped in and like notes for my acting classes. And now you get together with actors and they're talking about like what's my political standpoint, what's the cause that I'm championing, what's the brand I'm pushing, and like, does anybody want to talk about the craft? Because that's the only thing any of us have in common.
Right.
And nobody talks about it anymore. I could talk about acting all day long.
Yeah.
It's a challenging thing to do.
Right.
But why don't people talk about it? Does it feel like it's self-important?
I think, yeah. I think for some, I mean, I know actors who, it's all they want to talk about. And some of them you want to say, you should talk about this less.
Yeah. Not interested.
But I am interested, very much so. So let's talk about, well, the other thing we have in common.
Yes.
As we both worked on a film that was a part of Project Greenlight.
Oh.
And you, of course, ended up working with a certain actor in his first starring role in a film. One Shia LaBeouf. Did you see any of the Nuts Party of One coming down the pike?
I think he's ridiculously talented.
Absurdly.
He's one of those actors that you're like, you got it. Yeah. I see it. And I still believe it.
I do too.
I just think that becoming that wildly famous is really challenging.
It's nearly impossible. I agree.
I don't fault anybody.
Yeah.
He's wildly talented.
Good for you.
Yep.
I saw him last night. I got stuck down the rabbit hole of the movie Fury, and I can recommend it. I saw the trailer.
Oh, you saw him in a movie. I thought you meant in person. I was like, how is he? Tell him I say hi.
Sammy, get him on the phone. Sammy worked with him, of course, in The Freaks and the Geeks.
I love him. Mm-hmm.
I saw the trailer for Fury. I saw, Brad Pitt's in another World War II movie. What else is on? Mm-hmm. Right? When it came out, did it make more than $9?
It did okay.
It did okay. I watched it. It should have done way better than okay.
Oh, wow.
It is fascinating. Yeah, and he was underplayed, understated, and kind of wonderful.
He's wonderful.
Yeah.
He's wonderful. He'll come back.
Well, that kind of talent just needs to get their head straight.
He just needs to get refreshed.
And I agree this thing about crazy, insane, over-the-top success.
It's too much.
Who handles that in their 20s?
Why do you need to? I think it's too young. I don't think an actor should start till they're like
25. They should go to the head of the studio or network and say, I'm not ready.
I'm not ready.
I need to be at the back of the cast.
She's like, okay, wait till you're in your 30s to figure this out.
When you were telling that story, I was like going through a list in my head of all like the young actors who were brilliant that we've lost, like Ashaya or Lindsay Lohan. She's
so
amazing in Mean Girls, and then now it's like, I don't know what the hell she's
truly
doing.
Gifted.
Yes.
Crazy.
But
crazy
just, too
good. Yeah, I've known her forever, and I think she's incredibly talented, and she probably would be if she could, you know, straighten it. But you can't fault them. Like, I was at some SAG dinner the other night, and we were talking about how our contracts are coming up, blah, blah, blah. And then I was like, what are we doing for the young actors? I always have this, like, idea of, like, we should have a psychologist meet these young actors before they start a project, and then they should meet the kids at the end of the project. And if anything's happened to them,
right,
psychologically in between the shooting, then like somebody in the production should be responsible,
right,
for like rehabbing these kids, because it's not fair.
Yeah,
they looked at me kind of like, okay, lady.
Well, because everyone thinks that everyone wants massive success, and so few people get it, and they rarely step out of that massive success and say, this is fucking me up.
You want it. I think we all want it. There's nothing wrong with wanting it, but it's like what it's become.
Yes.
Is too insane. Like what it was when we were on Roswell and Freaks and Geeks is wildly different than what it is today.
Sure.
There's too much access and there's too many people hounding you, and it's like when you're really trying to figure yourself out, like how can you be answering questions about who I am and what my beliefs are and having that responsibility?
Right.
And nobody says anything to you when you're that successful. Nobody's saying no. Nobody's
you can do whatever you want. You are encouraged to be
wild.
Yeah.
And you be yourself, be bold, make moves. And it's like, you know, you're 22. Sit in the corner and watch people who know what they're doing. Just be quiet until you figure it out because you don't know what you're talking about.
It's a perfect time to segue into.
Am I a bummer of an interview?
This is spectacular.
Okay. No.
This is.
It was like funnier at the beginning, and then I feel like it's gotten real serious. We'll edit this down.
This will prove to you that you're not. Okay. I usually like start tuning out.
Okay.
And the fact that I'm interacting
okay,
so
fantastic.
Much.
Wow. That's a great message to our past guest. Jamie's been tuning out for 7 years.
Now I'll start to, you know, get distracted. Okay.
No, you have to look
She's
over.
She's like, I'm on Just Jared right now.
What you're saying is you're dialed into this conversation, Jamie.
Correct.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, no, and also, listen, this is not a comedy show. I mean, where I'm vastly interested in people's journeys, as I mentioned to you at the outset. Okay. I want to segue into how you created the character in your current multi-award winning show. But first, I believe I have a live ad read to do from a sponsor.
Love it. Love a good sponsor.
Right?
Love a good sponsor.
Fracture, take a moment if you'd like some more water, Brian would be happy to get it for you. Fracture, ladies and gentlemen, children around the world, is a photo decor company that is out to rescue your favorite images from the digital ether. Pay attention, Sam Levine.
Oh, I'm paying.
They print your photos directly onto glass and add a laser-cut rigid backing. This is something for Julia Kay. So they're ready to display right out of the box. They even include the wall anchor. Just upload your digital photo, pick your size, it's that simple. The fracture process makes the color and contrast of your photo really pop, and the sleek frameless design lets your photo stand out while still matching any decorative style. You heard me, decorative style. Bring a special memory to life, give it as a unique gift, and decorate your home with the moments that tell your story. Fractures come with a 60-day happiness guarantee, so you're sure to love your order. 60-day happiness guarantee. 2 months to send it on back and say, give me my cash, you son of a bitch. Each fracture is handmade in Gainesville, Florida.
It's made in America.
It's America.
Come on.
U.S. sourced materials in their carbon neutral factory. For more information or 10% off your first order, visit fractureme.com/podcast. Don't forget to mention Kevin Pollak's chat show in their one question survey. That's it, folks. Just the one question. And you'll help support this show, fractureme.com/podcast. And we thank Fracture for their sponsorship so that I can pay my crew a stipend. Okay, so there's the ridiculous opportunity through Roswell that you learn from. You then go do some movies. And Roswell was enough of a success that you must have had pilots being sent your way.
No.
All righty. You must have had representation that were sending pilots.
I was auditioning. Yes, I was being sent my way to audition. Yes, yes.
Sure.
Yes.
And so tell me the genesis, if you wouldn't mind, of the program we know as Unreal.
Sure. So I had done a television show called Life Unexpected around the time that I was 30, and I came off of it, and my career was pretty flat, which happens.
Sure, ebb and flow.
Ebbs and flows. And so I did Dating Rules. I did Dating Rules, and I kind of decided, you know what, my career as an actress is getting pretty flat. This is very challenging. I am going to focus on directing. Because at least with directing, I can be proactive.
100%.
And so I started shadowing. And so I reached out to a friend of mine, Jenny Connor, who is the executive producer on Girls. I said, can I come shadow on Girls? And so I shadowed on Girls, and that's how I got the job on Girls
as
an actress. And that part really sort of gave my career more breath, and so I started working again. And I did like a Christmas movie for Lifetime. This is what I did post-Girls, was a Christmas movie for
Haven't
Lifetime.
Haven't we all done a Christmas movie
a Christmas
for Lifetime?
Yeah, exactly. Our
former neighbor, Brian Del Murray.
Brian Del Murray, I love the Christmas movies. Yeah, it is Santa Claus movie. Every other year.
And so I got the script for Unreal, and I am a deadline stalker. I read it many times a day. And so I had seen the short that this show was based on, because I had seen it on Deadline as an announcement. And so when I got the script, I was like, I told John, my husband, I was like, this is really good. I can totally get it. I understand the tone. I think this could be great, but it's on Lifetime. Like, what? That's.
It was one of my questions. How much of a concern?
It was Lifetime. And he said to me before I even went to the audition, he's like, "So what? What if you become the girl of Lifetime? Like, go
or the show of Lifetime?
Yeah, become Lifetime. Like, no big. That's not going to be a bad move for you.
It's hard to remember what AMC was
before Breaking Bad, exactly, and Mad Men. Sorry, wrong show, but yeah.
No, both.
Both of them. So I went to the audition.
USA before Monk and now before Mr. Robot.
Exactly. Yeah. So I went to the audition. I came out. There was a lot of interest. And I went to the audition. I ended up getting the job.
And there was a little bit of fear, but I was also like, listen, there's so much TV today that if it doesn't do well, it'll just disappear. And if it does, great, then I've like launched a network and yay, so much more success.
Sure.
And so we did a pilot and it was really bad. And
how much of the same cast?
Not a lot. I mean, some of the same cast. So we went to the screening of it, and John, my husband, fell asleep in the screening. We like get into the car, and he's like, shut the door. He's like, I really pray for you that this thing does not get picked up. This will kill your career.
Wait, oh my God, so dumb. Slow down, you had me at shut the door.
Shut the door. We can't let anybody hear. This was horrible. This will be over for you. I was like, oh man. And then a handful of months later, the show gets picked up, and he was like, okay, let's just make some money. Let's do it quick. Nobody needs to know about this. And they recast some people. They brought Constance in. We went to Vancouver. We got a new director. Same script. Script never changed. And
did you reshoot the pilot?
They used it as a proof of concept.
Right.
And then they threw it away. We started over. Which was interesting because you knew the material so well, and I had seen it a handful of times, so I was able to like make changes and be like, okay,
yeah,
and kind of really focus. And the tone was something that we really talked about a lot on set, especially with the younger actors. They would be saying to me like, what's the tone, Shiri? What's the tone? I was like, the tone is newsroom. Like, this is newsroom behind the scenes of reality. We have to play this as real and as serious, and if you lean into the comedy, it just doesn't work. And we made it in Vancouver. I'd say in 10 months, it went by before it even aired. Mm. So we made it, shot it. And so to have any kind of critical response was really shocking.
Sure. Constance
Zimmer.
Zimmer's character was in the original.
She was in the original pilot.
Obviously, her interpretation
was
Constance
different.
Zimmer's going to bring Constance Zimmer.
That's right.
To whatever she does. Your guys' chemistry on the show together is insane.
So we have a lot of friends in common. We'd never met before, but all of our friends, when I said, oh, Constance is gonna come do the show, they're like, how do you guys not know each other? You're like the same person, essentially. We met at the farmer's market, and you know, like one of the first days of work, I said to her, I'm like, listen, it's like really the central love story of the show is the two of us. She was like, I'm on board. And the wonderful thing about the two of us is that we're both moms, and we're both married, and we just like, there's not really any nonsense. We're like, let's do the show. Let's make it as good as we can make it. Let's make as much money as we can make it, and let's get out of here. Like, no drama. It's an incredibly positive, supportive set. Everyone comes to work, like, ready.
Craig Bierko, former guest of the show.
I've known him since I was, like, 17. He gave me the best advice ever to be an actor, which was get a good shrink when I was 17. And so we just get along really well, and there's a tremendous amount of respect between us.
Yeah.
And I think, as you said, like, it comes across on screen.
Absolutely. So the shadowing directors still helped you tremendously.
Completely. It helped me give me a career again. Because I feel like whenever you're, like, really at the bottom in your career in this business, you kind of have to do something yourself to jumpstart it.
100%.
So I was like, I will just shadow. I'm not working. I'm not gonna sit around and just be a non-working actor. So I shadowed, and every time I shadowed on Franklin and Bash, and then I ended up getting two episodes on that show as an actress. But again, it just let me have more opportunity to watch and be like, okay, what is this? Like, you know, when you're acting on a show, you can't really have any perspective because you're focused on what are my lines, how do I look, does this person like me, blah, 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 what's happening? So I was able to just like step back and also see like who are the producers? What does it mean to produce a show? Like how does this thing actually get made? Who's actually in charge? Like what is this thing?
The pecking order and also the functions of everyone.
And so now I've started, last hiatus I shadowed the head of Lifetime, the head of A&E Studios, and then the CEO of the entire A&E branch, this woman Nancy Dubuque, she runs seven networks. I went to New York and I shadowed her for a day. And so now I'm starting to get like a better sense of like what is this actual business that we're in, because the business is rapidly changing.
Oh, yeah.
And figuring out, and once you start to get that high up and you're in those meetings, you're like, not only does the actor not get mentioned, the show rarely gets mentioned. It's like, how is the network doing as a whole?
Yeah.
And you realize that the show is just a piece of that puzzle. It's an important piece.
Right.
But like, you can so easily as an actor take that show down, and you can take it down, but they're going to fill that piece with something else.
Yeah.
So learning more about how the structure of this entire industry works has been really fascinating.
Yes. The more you are able to pull back and also rise up, you see how truly unimportant the thing that we were obsessing over is to the big picture. Which is another reason, getting back to SAG, those of you around the world wondering what the hell we're talking about, the Screen Actors Guild is what we're talking about, why we'll never win another go-round, because the conglomerates that now own the studios, they're worried about a dock strike in Brazil more than they are this little actors union.
I don't know if that's true, though.
Yeah, well.
I don't know if that's
tell
true.
Tell me how you're not sure.
Because I feel like you can't actually make anything without the actors.
Of course.
And so what I've learned, which we've all learned from the cast of Friends, is if we actors can band together and say that this is what we need. Like, we don't want to sign deals where you're holding us for a year and a half and we can't go do other television shows when you're only making shows that run for 10 episodes and there's no longer residuals.
Right.
So if, as a group, if you band together and say, no, we can't do this, we need the structure of things to change.
There's the conundrum.
What?
The actors banding
together. The actors need to band. But we have a new SAG president.
Yeah. And we have a new SAG president. And also, you and I have had this conversation many times over the years. And this is the first time SAG and AFTRA are one union.
That's correct.
Right. So what do we do about this issue? I'm 100%
behind. Well, SAG, Gabrielle Carteris has started to now have these dinners, which I went to, where she's getting all these actors together. I'll happily put you in touch. But where she's talking about what are the issues and let's hear the issues.
Right.
And so that when we go to the negotiating table, we can all be on one side. Because it's not that we're going to get pushed aside as long as we're standing together, because they need us. Who will perform your roles and sell your projects?
Right.
YouTube stars?
In theory.
In theory, it sounds good.
No. You're 100% correct, but that's always been the belief, and it's always been the strong point. And the last time we were brutalized in negotiations is when I developed what I don't think is a cynical view, which is simply, the companies now that own the studios and the networks are so gigantic.
Correct.
That the studio, which we think in this town is the biggest thing in the world, is 7% of their pie chart of annual income. So if that studio shuts down for 10 months, and I own...
I don't think that's true.
World...
It's still worth billions and billions of dollars a year.
Yes, but it costs billions of dollars. Well, here's my other issue. Tell me about this one. I've always heard 5% of the actors, both unions, are gainfully employed.
Right.
100% are the voters.
Mm-hmm.
So the wild larger percentage of unemployed actors are going to absolutely step in line with what you're talking about, which is we need to band together. Because they're already not working.
Mm-hmm.
It's getting the 5% that are making a ridiculous living.
It's about getting that 1%.
To step
it's like
forward.
Who is the top? Who are those top people that show up and say, it's not like Brad Pitt doesn't need to negotiate a better deal because he's getting whatever deal he needs.
But don't you think that's when it's going to change?
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
When they stand up and say, hey, it's for all these other actors that are number 17 on the call sheet, they need a better deal so that they can afford to sustain to life.
Maybe we go after George Clooney, who's already proven he can save countries.
Yeah, yeah. Ask him to save our union.
Right?
I'll put you in touch.
Yeah, Don Cheadle.
Yep.
All of them.
Get the Ocean's crew back together to save acting.
Save the SAG union.
Cheadle's a pal, and he was sitting here at this very table telling us about the water crisis and how it's really Central California. Let's get him involved in the SAG after
go-round. There you go.
When does the contract come up?
It's coming up next year in 2017. She's doing these dinners now.
Okay.
If anything, you'll get a good meal.
That's right.
Thumbs up for the dinner. Who cares?
They gave a great tote bag.
Tell me what the winning the Peabody mean.
I didn't even know you could win a Peabody. I thought it was only Sesame Street and Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. I didn't really know what it was. I mean, it was great. I wore a fancy dress. I was shocked that we were there.
Does it affect the cast and crew when you're at work?
No, you're in Canada. You're we want a Peabody. They're what is that? They're Canadian.
It's extraordinary,
first of all,
for a television show to win.
Yeah.
It was kind of a huge deal.
It was a big deal. Yeah. I mean, it felt like a big deal at the time. Not really a big deal, but it just felt exciting and nice.
It's a different kind of award that almost has nothing to do with show business and therefore is automatically more important.
It felt, exactly. It just felt like, oh, wait, we're actually spending our time doing something that is having some sort of cultural relevance, and that's really exciting to be part of the conversation.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the thing I felt about the show also as a fan. Mm-hmm. It was one of my obsessions in New York working on this movie.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, was binging the all the episodes.
Oh, cool.
To be a part of a show that people are talking about in that way, mm-hmm. that's a very fairly new thing for an actor. Mm-hmm. You know, my favorite thing back in the 90s or whatever is people would come up, and maybe they still do, but owning DVDs was, you know, such a huge thing. For people to come up and say, I love you in X movie. You know, I own that movie. And I want to say, well, actually, Warner Brothers owns it. Idiot, you have a copy. Mm. But the pride of the proprietary sense of it.
Yeah.
And I feel that is what the binging thing is about. Because now you're, I remember 4 or 5 years ago, people were talking about the major networks are going to have to wake the fuck up because the next generation of viewers are not going to know what time slots mean.
Uh-huh.
They're going to watch something whenever they feel like it.
Right.
And we used to think in terms of the NBC lineup on Thursdays.
Must see TV.
Must see TV.
Yeah.
And then it was event program or mm-hmm. something like that. Maybe event isn't the right word, but it was you.
Sporting events are the only like are the,
it's the only live
and the Oscars
thing, and also these sporting events are now driving the billion-dollar business that is the massive mm-hmm. broadcast networks. So to be a part of something that's, you know, not just in the zeitgeist, but mm-hmm. that people are passionate about mm-hmm. at this point mm-hmm. in your life, having gone through the success of Roswell with its own ridiculous rapid fan base mm-hmm. of that genre.
It feels incredible, especially to be an adult in that situation, and right. makes you feel like, wait, I am capable. People are seeing me now for who I am, and like I have more to say, and so you have more of a platform in which to say it, and there's right. more opportunity, and you're like ready to like, you know, utilize that opportunity. It feels awesome. And just to walk in a room and be like, when people are like, I've seen your show, you're like, well, thank you.
Yeah.
I'm glad you watched it, but also like makes you feel like proud of yourself.
Right. And the actual work, when did you shoot season 2?
We shot it March 1st. We finished like June 18th. And then we go back for season 3, February 1st.
Pretty damn exciting.
Awesome.
How many times per shooting schedule do you go to Chupino's?
Chupino's, that's so funny. Maybe once when the producers come up in town because it's expensive.
It was a 10-episode second season, right?
Yeah, 10 episodes, and we'll do a third season of 10 episodes.
That's a long time.
We had 16 months off between the first and second season, in which I had got pregnant, had a child, and was able to lose the weight and go back to work.
Yeah, I was going to ask.
In my hiatus.
I was going to ask. What is season 2 and birthing like?
It was intense because I was like, season 2, I was 2 months after I had my son. And so I was like, you know, still nursing. And what I quickly realized is that like 100 men don't want to hear about breastfeeding. So you just were like 1027. I'm 1027. And I just go to my trailer and like pump. And I mean,
I hadn't heard that since I worked with Schwarzenegger.
It like presented it.
On Junior.
That's funny. It presented challenges, but, you know.
I'm sorry, is 1027 the code
for? We came up for a code for breastfeeding.
Oh, you came up with
1027.
One. Okay.
1027.
Because that's some inside baseball stuff. 10,
that's
10,
what
one.
It was, yeah. 1027.
Okay.
I have to relieve myself.
Man. Picking up and going to Vancouver, we talked about the idea of your parents saying, we're not going to Arizona to do this show.
Mm-hmm.
So what does it mean now for these, how many months to shoot 10 episodes?
3.5.
Not horrible.
It's not a long time. John and I talked about it a lot. He's like, you know, my husband has all these restaurants. And we're both like very like driven. We have like big dreams. And
yeah, 3 restaurants. When do you see him?
Oh, we have 8.
Sorry.
Yes, 8. And a full service catering company.
When do you see him?
A lot. He's like running the business. He does really, I mean, we really make it work.
He's become brilliant at delegating.
Yeah, he's a big business. It's a big company right now.
we just figured that the 3.5 months apart, you know, away, the kids come with me, two kids, two nannies with me in Vancouver, that what there is to gain, there's so much more to gain than what we're actually sacrificing. And in a way, he comes up every week and a half, 2 weeks, he comes for 5 days, and it's like he spends more time with them in the 5 days than he would over those 2 weeks if we were at home.
Of course.
Because he's like not in the kitchen, he's not at work. And it's true, there's been so much to gain out of the success of the show. And yeah. So the kids are very young. I mean, they're 3.5 and 8 months. So it's still an adventure. We're not like pulling them out of third grade and like pulling them all, you know, she goes to different preschools.
Right.
So we're just hopefully teaching them how to sort of like acclimate to life.
What was it like for her on season two to be?
She like comes to set. Now she came to set the other day. I was doing Jenny Biggs' web series. And she came, I mean, a web series, guys. Okay, so we know. She comes out. I'm like, Natalie. She's like, where's my trailer? I don't even have a trailer. She's like, where's Shona? Was our craft service. Where's Shona? Where's the truck? I'm like, there is no truck, Natalie. There's a table. There's so her expectations are high.
Yeah.
She has a trailer on Unreal. She knows everybody. She comes on set. She knows she has to be quiet. But one of the best moments so far of my career has been like directing, having my daughter there, and then she's needing her mom. So she's on my hip. And I have, you know, 50, 60 men following me around, like blocking this like four scene shot. And she's sitting there taking it all in and being like, see, mommy can be the, see, mommy's in charge, you see? And, but also like a woman can do this. A woman can work, and you see when what happens, what it looks like when a mommy's working. And I don't know if it's, she just has more respect for me, but it feels like she understands that mommy has to go to work.
Yeah.
Mommy's work.
It's amazing.
Yeah, I think it's pretty awesome.
And it sounds like you could afford Chipinos.
I mean, I could afford Chiappino's, but we just bought a new house, so we're not going to eat there.
You said something about eight restaurants. I want to encourage you.
Yeah, eight restaurants.
I'm friendly with the owner and the brothers, Celestino and Pino.
Oh, Chiappino's?
Yeah.
We like that restaurant.
Yeah.
There's also a lot of good Chinese food.
Oh, man.
And the sushi
in Vancouver,
up
and so we eat a lot of Chinese food.
The dim sum
is amazing. It's every Sunday.
The craziest dim sum I think I've ever had was in Vancouver.
Sin Su Hua is where we go every Sunday. The address is 3888 Main Street. If you're interested, I can send you my order. Yep. So we are obsessed.
Yes.
Yeah.
And also, being from San Francisco, it always felt like a bit of a sister city. Mm. Who invited Goldblum?
Oh, that's my bit.
That's so funny.
Jamie's
the
bit.
Bugs.
It's Jamie's bit for a fly. Pardon me, I had the broccoli. Did you want me to check anything here, Jamie?
There's one question that I actually kind of
Please.
Thought was interesting.
Cough it up.
Oh, you don't want to read it?
I'd like you to... We'd like to involve the live audience. That's
oh,
viewing.
I love that.
Yeah, yeah.
I thought it was an interesting question just because how passionate you are about the craft of something. So...
Oh.
Grante 101, this is from the chat room, would like to know if you would ever consider doing a Marvel movie.
Oh, that is number one on my list.
Ah.
Why? Excellent question, by the way.
I would love to do a Marvel movie. I want to be in something that's like seen that much. I think it's like very much of the culture right now.
Right.
I just think it would be interesting. I'm really interested in like who's making what at the highest level.
Yeah.
That's like the highest, like it's
mass
audience.
I knew this would be a good question for you.
It's really what I want to do. I really want to do a Marvel movie. I know they're doing like Margot Robbie is leading one in 2017 that's going to be all women. I would love to be a female superhero. And also I have children. Mm-hmm. How awesome to be in something that they would actually be proud to say, like, my mom's this badass superhero.
Yeah, the Jew who kicked ass.
The Jew who kicked ass. Shiri Appleby.
Yeah, I've always said, you haven't seen anything until you've seen a small Jew kicking ass. And now I know more than ever it's true. Well, we talk a little bit about John. So
okay.
I foolishly was just talking about Animal, Son of a Gun, and John and Vinny. But there's eight.
Yes.
Are they all in Los Angeles?
Yes. So there
Holy
is
crap.
Animal, Son of a Gun, John and Vinny's, and then they've sort of started becoming like producers of restaurants and partnering with other chefs and sort of building out the infrastructure and teaching
Genius.
Them how to run restaurants. And so they have three restaurants with the chef Ludo Lefay, Petit Trois Mecs, and Trois Familia.
And then seven, so that's the first six that are currently open. Seven will be in Sherman Oaks. It'll be Petit Trois, the second location. And then in episode eight, restaurant eight will be with two young women who are doing like a Mediterranean restaurant called Kismet. And that will be in Santa Monica. And that'll be, not Santa Monica, Silver Lake. And that'll be open by the end of the year.
Wow.
Yep.
Ever expanding empire.
Yes.
Pretty damn exciting.
It's really exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Jamie, I know we met him when we had dinner with the Biggses. The Biggses.
Yes, we're friends with the
Biggses. Came by the table. They're pals, I inquired. So I guess what I'm leading to is that you can get us a brunch reservation.
I can, no problem. I can get you in. I can get you in.
People have been yelling at me about brunch at John and Vinny's for way too long.
We went this morning. It's really great. We did. We went this morning. It was fabulous.
He wasn't working or you just went?
No, we know. Sunday family day. That's where we went.
Spectacular.
Yeah. It's so fun, and you know, kids are running around, crayons on the table, and it's like the kind of place that we were hoping to build, in the sense that like it's the kind of place that you want to take your kids to after they have like baseball practice. Mm-hmm. You go to John and Vinny's and get a pizza and get a, you know, some soft serve ice cream and hang out and create memories.
She loves the soft serve.
Who doesn't love soft serve?
I like a good old vanilla cone with rainbow sprinkles.
There you go. There you go.
And they're kind of, because the Foster's Freeze near us turned into a Dunkin' Donuts, it's hard to find. I have to go to like, actually, no, Rita's will do it, but it's a vanilla custard. I'm talking about this way too much.
No, go.
I love a good soft.
Please.
But it's, Rita's will do it, but it's vanilla custard, but I like that. I like that it's
good
thick.
Good donuts
yeah.
with custard yeah. on the inside.
So. You have.
A John of Itty's.
That's what I meant.
Yeah, John of
Itty's. Hi. Getting really hungry.
Hungry? I know, I'm hungry. We didn't really
progress. Go for lunch.
Call ahead. And then he and his partner won the James Beard Best in the
they
West.
Did.
Is that what the thing was?
They won Best Chef West Coast this year. Mm-hmm.
That's in, like yeah. the top of.
It's like the Oscars.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how wonderful is that in terms of. I find that for actors, we have to be so proactive that it also forces us to be more self-involved than your average bear, mm-hmm. Almost as a way to survive. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if you had always dated or frequently or whenever dated someone who is that proactive in their own. Mm-hmm. careers and diversifying, because mm-hmm. we talk about writing and directing and,
right.
and acting and seeing the bigger and bigger and bigger picture.
Yeah.
So what is that like as a partner?
He's fantastic. I mean, my mom always says that she thinks I'm more driven and more focused now than I've ever been because I have a partner like John in my life. And he's really about, you know, building out the brand
yeah.
and also doing really high quality work and not necessarily, and it's really like, I think our focus is like not about like focusing on publicizing, or it's more about do quality work and the people that you want to work with will come find you.
Absolutely.
And so it's just really about, that's really, I mean, we talk about it endlessly.
Yeah.
We're just talking about work endlessly.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah. And yeah. not in sort of a it's not about like us, it's more about like, What can we create? Like what pieces can you bring together? Like what are we capable of? And like I think building something is what we're really fascinated by, as opposed to like putting ourselves on the cover of a magazine or something like that.
Right. And you were saying off camera he just did his company catering for a Clinton thing.
Yeah, he catered for the Clintons. He catered for Obama, which Obama was interesting because I was like, wow, this is like you're cooking for a sitting president. And so, no, the president comes with his own cooler of his own food, his own water, his own silverware, like nothing, like he can't eat or touch anything.
Because everything's been Secret Service within
Correct.
An inch of his life.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? I thought that was fascinating. And then he cooked for Clinton recently, former President Clinton, and he's a vegan. So he made him vegan food. I know, my vegan friend's like, what do you make? And John was like, I have no idea.
No, I'm laughing because of like the Phil Hartman going to McDonald's and as Clinton. Like,
oh, and just, Clinton was running for office.
Yeah, you know, he's a total vegan after his heart attack.
I had to put down the fries.
Yeah,
but I just think of him like, you know, like shoving nothing. Fries on his face.
No butter, nothing.
No butter, nothing.
Nothing.
No joy.
Yeah, it makes sense that a president should not allow other people to be involved in the ingredients.
Nothing. Not a glass of water.
It really does make a lot of sense.
Not a darn thing.
And then I saw in the research Harrison Ford. So now we couldn't be bigger fans of the Harry Ford.
He worked for Harrison Ford, though, before he even had a restaurant.
Right.
He was sort of like a handyman. He would, like, paint their house and organize, like, furniture and take photos. He kind of became very
Harrison
close.
Ford's not building his own furniture? Terrible.
Yeah.
And then come on.
His former wife, who's just passed away, was really helped give him their start in the business. Melissa Matheson, mm-hmm. She really helped. Like she really believed in John and Vinny at the beginning, and like helped get them into like certain families to start catering for them and help them get started.
We have a friend of the poker game who did this for the guy. I'm forgetting his name. Damn me, who is behind Bestia downtown?
Mm-hmm.
Was the same thing where he's catering, you know, small parties. And
that's how he started.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he still caters for a lot of the people he was catering for back then. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. It's just awesome to wake up next to somebody who's really passionate and is like really living what they sort of preach and able to build something. And you just realize that like being a good person and working hard, like it does pay off if you just sort of stay focused.
I'm sorry you have to wake up every morning next to a mooch. It doesn't do anything.
So not true. Do you want to give a shout out to the 826 folks? You're going back September.
Oh, we'll be going back soon because school's starting. Nah, it's all right.
826 LA, the wonderful... you know, this nonprofit
no.
is doing great stuff. For
we people. Teach creative writing to grade school kids, and they do after school tutoring for free as well.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it is pretty
That's
great.
That's awesome.
I won them $10,000 on Hollywood.
Yeah, they still have
squares.
Hollywood Game Night.
Hollywood Game Night.
With Jane Lynch,
I wish we had Hollywood Squares. I was like, really good one.
Got Match Game.
They brought back Match Game. I can't thank you enough. I won't keep you
thank
any further
you.
From your family now as it's ever expanding. More? Are you going for more than two?
No, I think we're.
You hit the. You're good.
He's done.
He's done. Well. I can't thank you enough.
Thank you. I had so much fun.
Honestly and truly.
Thank you.
I've watched over the years and been incredibly happy and having nothing to do with what I might have overheard in the car.
That's funny.
No, just really, really, I'm glad you remembered that because thankfully I had forgotten. continued success. So you go back to work in February.
Yep.
And then the new season begins for Unreal when?
Sometime in June.
Sometime in June.
Yeah, summer.
Oh, it's so exciting.
Thank you.
This was a great, this second season was really great. No?
Thank you.
Did you feel like?
Yeah, it was really, I was happy with it. Yeah.
Because that's the thing, when you do a first season that launches as well as it did, oh boy, we have to do this again.
That's exactly
and
right.
We have to somehow get better
yes.
at this.
And you can hopefully keep getting better and expanding. And
did we'll they write in the Bierko weight loss because he lost all the weight? Or,
yes.
Or did they say,
no.
Craig,
he lost all the weight.
Blown up like a poison dog, come back to us.
He got pretty big.
And Boo is in every scene he's in.
Every shot. Yeah.
He brings his dog Boo into he brought him into the show.
He brings him everywhere. He brings her everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the therapist can't be there every day. So you got to have
you
Boo.
You said it.
Well, I love you dearly and
thank
honestly,
you so
truly,
much.
Truly happy for all of it. And thank you for sharing some of your Sunday with us.
My pleasure.
I'll have to go to you for a famous question for Brett Gelman when he's here in a couple of weeks, right?
Fantastic. I'll ask you.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Sit there uncomfortably while I wrap things up
Please
for the folks
do.
At home, and thank
Please
you
do.
Again.
My pleasure.
Shiri Appleby, ladies and Jews, bring those paws
ladies
together.
And Jews,
that's how
I
you
love
do it.
That. I'm going to use that from now on, ladies.
Ladies and Jews, please feel free. I just realized I'm going to be doing some stand-up in Seattle in a couple of weeks.
Get the fuck out of
yeah,
here.
Yeah, I just realized I should probably mention that if you know the comedy place there that I should remember. Live. Yeah, I think it's called Live.
Oh, boy.
Look up real quick. J-Mac, Google real quick.
Kevin Pollak, Seattle Comedy,
yeah,
2016.
Stand-up Live. I'm pretty sure it's called Stand-up Live.
Okay.
In Seattle. Pretty damn sure.
Playing the
but let's confirm that before
Stand
we sign
Live
off,
is Jane. Definitely the name of a chain of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Confirm that I'm there the like the 8th, 9th, and 10th or the 9th.
Seattle Comedy Underground? Does that sound right?
Nope. I usually work there.
Hey, as long as we're doing plugs.
Yeah, please, Sammy.
Our next live show. What do you got? Our next live show, which I believe is going to be Sunday, September 11th.
With Brett Gelman.
With Brett Gelman. That is the very same day that you can log on to roosterteeth.com and check out my brand new streaming series, Crunch Time, which was the one I was working on last summer.
Roosterteeth.com?
Roosterteeth.
Oh, Rooster Teeth.
Yes.
Because there was a comedy club in
Rooster
the Bay
Teeth.
Area.
Rooster yes.
Teeth Feathers.
Rooster Teeth Feathers, yeah.
Roosterteeth.com.
Roosterteeth.com. It is $4.99 a month or free 30-day trial. So on
who doesn't
the,
like free?
On the 11th like of September, go ahead and sign up for a free 30-day trial.
Can't forget
first,
that date. Never forget.
Never forget.
You're trying
never
to create
forget.
New memories for 9/11.
Absolutely.
And I think that's
happier,
exciting.
Nicer memories that involve watching first our chat show in the early part of the day.
And then later.
Followed by going to roosterteeth.com and checking out Crunch Time.
Crunch Time.
Parlor Live Comedy Club.
Parlor Live is the name of it. Thank you very much.
There we go.
Parlor Live will be there the weekend of the 8 and
the
9.
Ninth.
Friday and 8, 9, and 10. Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Yeah. Kenny, anything?
I'll be in Seattle too.
Kenny's going to Seattle.
There's a big fried chicken convention Kenny's going to.
Have a great Labor Day, everybody. Remember to labor less. And I mentioned all the crew at the top of the show, so screw you. Thank them all. Not going down the list again.
I like them.
Yeah, they were great, right?
Yeah.
They're lovely people.
A little laughing community. Up
yeah, like it's nice. And thanks
we're
again.
We're mostly making fun of Sam.
Aw.
Why?
Samantha Ward, she left. It's not right to make fun of her while she's gone.
I do over here.
That's our show. So next time, we'll see you. We'll be the September 11th with Mr. Brett Gelman. Let us know. Write to us at...
KPCS Fan Mail.
It's been too long. I've been away for 5 weeks. KPCS Fan Mail, as in Kevin Pollak's Chat Show Fan Mail. KPCSFanMail@gmail.com. Let us know anything you'd like. I have an email here from Aaron Coates that I can't wait to read on September 11th. Until next time, and as always, get out of my face.